is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy.
Yes, yes, yes. That gives us room to sing, I would think. That gives us all the ground to shout and sing that we could ever think of. Good morning, good morning, good morning. It is Tuesday, the 7th day of March. We're well into March now, and I was just figuring out the other day it'd be my, let's see, for Sunday would have been my parents' 86th wedding anniversary, something like that, 84, 80, 86, somewhere in there. So, yeah. Just think of those things every once in a while. They pop into your mind. But it is good to see you all out there this morning. May God bless you. Teresa, you were first one up there this morning. First to pop in. God bless you, girl. Good to see you this morning. Buddy Julia, God bless. It is good to see Atlanta on board this morning on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon for you guys. Good morning to us. Good afternoon to you in Atlanta. We love you guys. Oh, would love to see you. We love you, love you. All right. Miss Ruth, good morning to you. Give a shout out to Kenneth and say hi to him for us as well. Debbie, good to see you there this morning. You just love what God's doing in your life, girl. Sue, good morning. And I see you got your big bunny too. So good morning to you, Miss Sue. Always so good to see you, Miss Sherry. Good morning, dear brothers and sisters. It is His amazing grace. Pray for Sherry. She's going to be going up with Michaela and Riley for a couple of days. Riley's going to have some surgery on her ears, and Sherry is going up to kind of help out because Michaela is there alone. So she's going to go up. I'm going to drive up Friday after the broadcast, pick her up, and we'll come back Friday night because we got stuff that's going to get done down here. But pray for her and pray for them as they're going to be on the road today, traveling back up to Joint Brace. Miss Terry, good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning to you. We love you. Rick, good morning to you. It is good to see you there as well. I hope you guys come to, I plan on being at Seeker's Brunch, so I hope I see some of you up there at Davidson's at 11 o'clock. Miss Jessica, good morning to you as well. We love you, and you give a big hug and kiss to Sadie, if you will. We would love that. Give a shout out and a hi to your mama if she's right there with you. Give her our love as well. It's good to see you guys. May God bless. Well, we are on our way this morning. I want to finish up with chapter 3 this morning, if you will. So if we run close to the clock, that's fine. If we're done a few minutes before, that'll be fine. But I got just, I think, about enough time. Yes, and yes, thank you. Big, big kiss right there on Sadie's cheek for us, if you would. All right. Well, we've been discussing, of course, the unpardonable sin. That's where most of our discussion was yesterday. And that whole discussion of the pardonable sin is held just after Jesus had healed a demon-possessed man who had been dumb. After the demon had been cast out, he could both hear and speak, which prompted the crowds to just really begin to question, in a real sense, who Jesus really is. Is he? Could he be the one that we waited for? Could he be the Messiah? Could he be that long-awaited anointed one of God? This prompted the scribes, who were sent down from Jerusalem to keep an eye on him and his activities, to respond. And they have to respond, you know, since they couldn't bring themselves in any way to accept even the possibility that he could be the Messiah, as many in the crowd had come to begin believing. they had to offer a differing opinion that would draw the people away from Jesus. In verse 22 of that third chapter, it says that the scribes came down from Jerusalem saying, "He is possessed of Beelzebub, and he casts out demons by the ruler of the demons." It would do us well sometimes to go back and read over this and watch the skill at which Jesus handles the critics. We can learn an awful lot in handling those that oppose the Word of God and oppose Christ as we watch as he relates and dialogues with these men in the various settings that they're in. He gives no quarter. Because they had an answer to what they saw. And they completely rejected, any alternative. And in their stubborn, hardness, in their fixatedness of their own position, they refused to acknowledge, even the possibility that Jesus was the Messiah. So this prompted Jesus specifically, and that's something I want you to know. He called these men to him. He didn't ignore them. He called them to him, and then he taught in a parable that they weren't going to understand. Later his disciples would, but they would not. It says in verse 23 that he called them to himself and began speaking to them in parables. We're going to talk about a little bit more about parables as we get into chapter 4, because chapter 4, chapter 5, they deal with Jesus teaching in parables. And we'll talk about what that is. We'll look at the specific parables that Mark uses to speak about, all right? But he called himself to them, he spoke in parables, and he asked the question, how can Satan cast out Satan? Now, that sets up the entire dialogue. In this parable, he completely destroys their argument by taking their logic, their own train of thought, their own logic, their own teaching. He turns it against them. I mean, he brings it out, he uses that in a marvelous and skillful way to destroy their argument, and proving again that he truly is Daniel's son of man who stood before the Ancient of Days, proving himself to be Messiah. Because as their teaching said, if only God can destroy Satan, then who does that make Jesus out to be then? He is Isaiah's mighty man, as he speaks of nobody can plunder a rich mighty man's house unless he goes in and first binds the mighty man, the strong man. He's the mighty man that enters into the tyrant's kingdom. And as Isaiah says, sets his captives free and rescues the prey of the tyrant and contends with the one who contends with us. These men's staunch refusal to accept that very fact led them to attribute the work of the Holy Spirit to Satan, which prompted Jesus to speak directly to them concerning the unpardonable sin. Let's go ahead and pray and jump right in, all right? Father, I thank you that we can review these things and nail them down, come to a fuller grasp and understanding of what your word says. Lord, give us clarity, and that's simply what I ask this morning, is that you give us clarity on this very important subject, because, Lord, it's twisted and manipulated and used in wretched ways, even by well-meaning men and women of God. So I ask you, Father, to give us clarity. Let us look at the Word. Let us not add to it or take from it, but let us look at it in and explore it and allow your Holy Spirit to lead us and teach us and to bring us into an understanding knowledge of what the Word of God says. And Lord, I pray this morning that we will have ears to hear and eyes to see. Bless us now, Lord, as we continue in this study of Mark. God, we love you. And we thank you for each and every one that is out there and have joined and is a part. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. In verse 28, it says, "Truly, truly," Jesus says to them, "I say to you, all sins shall be forgiven the sons of men, and whatever blasphemes they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin, because they were saying, he has an unclean spirit." Now, remember yesterday I told you that the key to any passage, really, but especially, you know, when you look at something like this that, you know, we struggle with, is context, context, context. Context is vitally, vitally important. That'll give us the key to this or any passage. If we're to understand what this terrible saying means, we must first understand the circumstances and the context in which it is said. It was said by Jesus to this group of scribes and Pharisees when they declared that the cures that he wrought were done not by the power of God, but by the power of the devil. These men, now understand, they had been able to look directly into the eye of the incarnate love of God. They were able to see Jesus in all of his earthly, if you will, majesty. And then turn that upside down and think and then declare that instead of the incarnate power of God, it was the incarnate power of Satan. Who is he speaking to? He's speaking directly, eye to eye, voice to voice, to these scribes and Pharisees. So in context, the scribes had been given all the evidence. They'd seen all the, they'd seen the miracle, especially this one, but they'd seen others. They had heard the teachings, and they still reject him as the Christ. They have just accused him of performing miracles by the power of Satan. They witnessed the power of the Holy Spirit, and they said, it's Satan, it's Beelzebub. They point to the Holy Spirit and say, unholy and unclean. They rejected the very one in whom it was necessary to believe in order to receive forgiveness. And as a result, there would remain no more possibility of forgiveness. These scribes made the most serious of all accusations that what Christ had done by the power of the Holy Spirit in testimony to his messiahship was attributed to the work of the devil. Now, I got to tell you, to have done that was to blaspheme God, which under the law, which they valued as being everything, they should have been taken out and stoned. But God's grace and mercy didn't do that. But he does give them a stern warning, a very precipice in which they're standing. Jesus is saying that it is the power of the Holy Spirit that is revealing who he is and what he came to do. Remember, the Holy Spirit had descended upon him, and I shared with you yesterday, you cannot consider this in the sense that you and I understand the work of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not been sent to indwell and infill the believer, the church, until the day of Pentecost. So this is prior to the cross, prior to Pentecost. So the Holy Spirit is seen and understood only in the Old Testament context. So there is evidence now in the Old Testament context of what they're looking at. And so, you know, they had all the evidence that they needed to attribute to God the glory that belonged to him. But they refused. The power of the Holy Spirit was made evident to them. Otherwise, Jesus wouldn't have said this. It was obvious that they had the evidence, it was made evident to them, yet they continued to reject. I want you to think of Pharaoh. How many times did Moses come to Pharaoh and said, let my people go? And Pharaoh hardened his heart. Let my people go, and Pharaoh hardened his heart. Let my people go, and Pharaoh hardened his heart. Over and over and over again. The last time you see that, when Moses comes, it says, and God hardened Pharaoh's heart. I mean, there was only one decision Pharaoh could make after that, and it would lead to his own destruction. God literally had turned him over to his own stubborn will. You see, the power of the Holy Spirit in this position has been made evident to them. The clear revelation of Christ as the Messianic King was affirmed by the unmistakable healing and deliverance by the power of the Spirit. It was totally rejected and declared to be the work of the devil. So they're attributing the work of God to Satan. Now I would tell you, technically in the sense that we see this in the context, the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit cannot be committed in the same way. Cannot be committed today. Why? And you know, people would disagree with me. There are those, I know, because I've read enough commentaries and what others have said about it, and have heard what many, even of my Baptist brethren, have said about it. But I believe this to be true. And the reason I say this is because Jesus is not physically on the earth. He isn't walking in his physical state here on earth, presenting himself to man in that way. And no one can witness Jesus Christ in the flesh performing a miracle and then being able to attribute it to the power of Satan instead of the Holy Spirit. Now, can we see the Spirit at work in the world? Absolutely. Can we see a God at work in the world? Absolutely. But can we see those who imitate, if you will? Can we see the charlatans out there? How do we know sometimes that that is the work of God and not the work of God? I mean, if somebody stands on a platform and he's teaching and preaching and he's blowing his breath out across the wind and say, receive the Holy Spirit, and people are being slain in the Spirit, they're falling on the floor, and people are saying, that's the work of God, that's the work of God, and I would say it's not. So you see, there's a big difference between now and this physical scene that we see playing out in Capernaum with Jesus having cast out a demon of a deaf and mute man and have the attribution of what they did, attributing that to Satan. Do you see the difference? This is why I say that technically, in the sense that we're seeing it here, the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit can't be committed because Jesus is not physically on the earth. No one can witness him in the flesh performing miracles and then attribute it to Satan. I believe that today, the only unpardonable sin is to die having rejected Jesus as Savior. Any sin can be forgiven. I mean, after all, didn't Paul attribute what was going on? Wasn't he a blasphemer, as he put it himself? He didn't see what was happening in the church. There's no evidence until the Damascus Road that he had any encounter with Christ at all, but only with Christians. He didn't see what was happening in the church as a work of God. He saw it as rebellion. He saw it as blasphemy against God. And he was attributing what they were doing as blasphemy against God. And he was set out with righteous indignation to stamp out the church. Am I not correct? Correct me if I'm wrong. I want to be corrected if I'm wrong. That's why Paul could say he was a blasphemer. But yet none of us can deny that Paul was saved. You see what I'm saying? But if they deny, if a person today, you may be listening out here, and you haven't accepted Christ, and you may pick this broadcast up and listen to it at some time, but you deny the personal work of Jesus Christ, there is no means by which God can forgive you, forgive them, because they denied the only way of salvation. That's the long and short of it. That doesn't mean that man cannot become so hardened by the very deceitfulness of sin that he will not respond to the overtures of the Holy Spirit after all, Scripture does tell us that the Spirit will not strive with man forever. And we do know, the writer Hebrews talks about the hardness of heart that comes from the deceitfulness of sin. The more we reject the light, the deeper the darkness is within our own heart. Remember Paul's words to the church? We certainly spent some time looking at it and continue to look at it on Sunday mornings. In Romans 1, professing to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the incorruptible God for the image in the form of corruptible man and a bird's four-footed animals and creature and crawling creatures. Therefore, God gave them over in the lust of their heart to impurity so that their bodies would be dishonored among them. Verse 25 says, for they exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Now, we spent some time looking at that. What does that say? Well, Paul says three times in that section that God gave them over, which simply means that God simply removes his restraining power, thus allowing the sin that they so cherish to take more and more control of their life until they are so blind they cannot see and so deaf they cannot hear. They're in the position that I mentioned Pharaoh. They're in the position that Pharaoh was in. God calls at them and they refuse to repent. They refuse to, and they harden their heart and they harden their heart. Ultimately, God has just turned them over to their sin to the point that their heart is so hard that they will not hear. That, to me, has become the unpardonable sin of our day. In fact, there will come a day, will there not, when God himself will send upon mankind an a deluding influence to where they will not even be able to see the truth and grasp the truth. I believe that'll happen to the majority of the world immediately after the aftermath of the rapture of the church that's stated in 2 Thessalonians. There'll come a day when God's restraining power will be lifted from this earth, and that which restrains evil and holds it back will hold it back no more. And men, well, they rather believe the lie than accept the truth. Well, take a look at that passage in 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, just verses 3 through 12. Let's look at that. Let's walk through that for a moment. Paul says, let no one in any way deceive you. For it, meaning the return of Christ, the gathering up of the people of God that he's talked about in 1 Thessalonians, when he says, I don't want you ignorant about those that are asleep, and he talks about the rapture, he talks about the resurrection. He says, let no man deceive you, for it will not come unless the apostasy comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, that's the Antichrist, who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God and object of worship, so that he takes his seat at the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. Remember, we talked about that in our study of Revelation. One day, 3.5 years into what is considered the time of Jacob's trouble, or we call it the tribulation, he will walk into that temple, and as Antiochus Epiphany did, at the end of the Old Testament, during that 400 years of silence, he's going to desecrate the temple, might even do what Antiochus did, slaughter a pig on the altar, set up an image of the beast there in the temple, and he'll declare himself to be God. Takes his seat on the mercy seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. Verse 5. Do you not remember that while I was still with you, I was telling you these things? And you know what restrains him now. What restrains the Antichrist? What restrains evil now? Well, simply put, it's the church. More specifically, it's the Holy Spirit working through the body of Christ to dispel evil, to be light in the world and salt, the salt of the world, earth. You know what restrains him now, so that in his time he'll be revealed. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. We understand that. Only he who now restrains will do so until he's taken out of the way. Verse 8. After he's taken out of the way, that lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will slay with the breath of his mouth and bring an end by his appearance of his coming. That is the one whose second coming is in accordance with the activity of Satan, or whose coming is in accordance with the activity of Satan, with all power and signs and false wonders, with all deception of wickedness for those who perish, because why? They did not receive the love of the truth so as to be saved. They perish. Why? Because they did not receive the love of the truth so to be saved. For this reason, God will send upon them a deluding influence so that they will believe what is false, in order that they may all be judged who did not believe the truth but took pleasure in wickedness. Do you see the clarity of all of that? Be thankful at this point in history, there is still the work of the Holy Spirit within the heart and lives of believers and within the church as he works through them in this world, holding back, retarding, and pushing back evil, restraining it. It's like it's on a tight leash, and it's restraining and being held back. But the day will come, because of the hardness of the hearts of men who refuse to receive the love of truth so as to be saved. They reject the light, they reject the light, they reject the light. Each time they do, we move further and further into darkness until God says the time is right, and he will literally remove that which restrains evil. In order to do that, he has to remove the church. When that happens, hell on earth will break loose, because there will no longer be the restraining power of evil. And that's why it's a rapid rush to the end from that point on. It'll seem like an eternity on earth, but it'll be a rapid rush to the end until Christ comes back and sets all things right. Mankind will have gone so far that God will completely turn them over to their own unbelief. Now, the unpardonable sin is to deny Jesus is the Christ. Every other sin can be forgiven, but to reject Jesus Christ as Savior, as Lord, leaves no means by which God can grant forgiveness. Remember, John 14:6, very clearly, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me." That truth is stated over and over and over again in the New Testament and in the Old. Jesus is the only way of salvation. We say that, and every time I say it, I know there are some that are offended by it. So they refer to us as being intolerant and rigid and judgmental and fundamentalists and narrow-minded and bigoted and, you know, you name it, homophobic, xenophobic, you get all the phobics in there that you want to. Consider how those verses read if you replace the word "the truth" with the name Jesus. Absolutely right. That's the foundation of all of that. Completely right, dear. So, if the unpardonable sin is to reject Jesus Christ, then no Christian can commit this sin. Our sins, all of them, are forgiven forever. Past, present, and even those future sins that you and I are going to commit. Colossians 2, verse 13. "And when you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions." The Greek word for forgiven here is charizomai. It means forgiveness as a result of grace or as an act of love. It means to bestow favor unconditionally. How many of our sins are forgiven? All of them. Not just the past sins before we got saved, or these that we commit today. Not just the big ones and the little ones, but all of them. Paul put it this way in Romans 1:8, "There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." This text teaches us that there is no condemnation, no punishment, no judgment for those that are in Christ. Why? Because all of our sin has been judged at the cross. There's no longer in Adam, and we are no longer in Adam, and will therefore not receive the punishment of Adam's sin. We are in Christ, and we receive the gift of Christ's righteousness. Romans 5, great, it'll be great when we get there. So then, as through one transgression there results in condemnation for all men, even so through one act of righteousness there results justification for the life to all men. For as through one man disobedience, the many were made sinners, even so through the obedience of the one, Jesus, the many will be made righteous. We are in Christ. Well, now Jesus has just laid out a bomb upon this Jerusalem delegation for having committed an unpardonable sin. They all only rejected him, but they were rejecting the whole package. And in turn, they'd been rejected by him. Then Christ turns his attention. The very next scene we see in this story within a story is Christ begins to speak about authentic family relationships. Take a look at verses 31. Through 35, to the end of the chapter. It says, then his mother and his brothers arrived. And standing outside, they sent word to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, behold, your mother and your brothers are outside looking for you. And he answered them and said, who are my mother and my brothers? Looking about at those sitting around him, he said, behold, my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. In that time frame, in that culture, that would have been a shocking, shocking statement. Now the family of Jesus arrives on the scene. They haven't come here to hear him preach. They haven't come to see any miracles. They've come to talk to him. In fact, they've come to do a little bit more than that. They've heard about his sudden rise in popularity. And they've concluded, because of what they're hearing about his teaching, listen, people, remember, we covered some of this. You know, they'd heard the kind of things that he was teaching. And it didn't fit their old synagogue school teaching. There was new stuff coming in here. They didn't know what to make of it. They still had also the prevailing concept of how the Messiah would come, when he would come, what it would look like, what would happen. We're going to be talking a lot more about that, especially when we get into the parable of the mustard seed. But they'd heard of his certain rise in popularity. They concluded, though, from all that they were hearing, that he had lost contact with reality, and they'd come to take him into custody, to get him the rest he needed or the help that he needed. And this we saw back in verse 21 when he said, and when his own people heard this, they went out to take custody of him, for they were saying he's lost his senses. And you see that phrase there, his own people, literally translate that's those from his side. Like I said before, this is a common figure of speech in the Septuagint that refers to someone's family. This passage may come as a shock to us or to others. This is especially so in light of the fifth commandment, to honor your father and mother, which was treated very seriously by the Jews, and I hope by us. But Jesus made clear, here's a new position. There's a new game in town, if you will. He was no longer a carpenter and a family man. He was, as God's chosen, the foundation and central pillar of a new people of God. A new and peculiar people were called. And it was with such that his loyalties now lay. His family hadn't come to listen or to learn, but to interfere with his ministry, to stop what was happening. It's interesting the way it's stated. They stood outside. Not only at this point in their life were they outside physically from where he was, on the outside of the house he was staying in, but they were outside his ministry and outside the will of God. You see, his brothers, and we're assuming to his sisters, they didn't believe in him. In fact, John puts it very plainly in chapter 7, verse 5, for not even his brothers believed in him. Now, we know that Mary believed in him. We know that Mary understood, at least to a level, who he was. But I don't think, as we shared earlier, I don't think Mary had any idea what that all entailed. It is all unfolding for her people as well. Even with the knowledge she had, even with the visitation from the angel, even with the everything that she had and bear testimony to who her son was, she still didn't have all the information she needed. She was not living in the enlightenment, if you will, that you and I live in. Not until the resurrection. But his family had grown up. His brothers, sisters, they'd grown up with him. They'd lived with him for many years, but they didn't believe that he was the Messiah of Israel. Let me ask you a question. I know this is really a stupid question. I grew up with two brothers. You think that they would believe something of, you know, like that of me? Of course not. And for good reason in our situation. You do understand. But, you know, it's no different. Families are families. Mary, Jesus' mother, had not been replaced in his affections. We know that. Only in his mission emphasis. He would still, would he not, even from the cross, provide for his mother when she needed it the most. But on this occasion, when many had gathered to hear Jesus, he pointed to another higher reality than of spiritual kinship, namely the family of God. He clarifies his position with the answer to his own question, who are my father, my mother and my brothers? In verse 34 and 35, he says, looking at those who were sitting around him, he said, behold, my mother and brothers, for whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. An early martyr, and I can't remember who it was. I got to do some research to get it because I wrote it in the fly leaf of a Bible. Is an early martyr said, Christians' only relatives are other saints. Those who have trusted in the Lord Jesus enter into a new familial relationship, a new family relationship, a family of saints here on earth and in heaven. I love to liken our church as that of a family. When people come in and they see the warmth and the love and the caring nature of our church, I said, listen, we are simply a family. A family that God has pulled together and breathed life into. And that's what we are as a family. Those who trusted in Jesus Christ, we enter into this new family of saints relationship that spans heaven and earth, if you will. Jesus changes the order of relationship and shows that true kinship is not just a matter of flesh and blood. Our adoption as sons and daughters of God transforms all our relationships and requires a new order of loyalty to God and his kingdom. If any man will follow after me, let him, he must hate his father and mother and wife and children and brother and sister, yea, his own life also. He must take up his cross and follow me. Is he telling me to hate my mom and my dad and my brothers and I don't have sisters, but you get the picture? No. But he's saying my love and loyalty to him has got to be so great that anything else would look like hatred. No, we're to love our mothers, our fathers, our brothers and sisters, but we're to love him supremely. Our adoption as sons and daughters of God transforms every relationship we got. And we need to ask ourselves from time to time, do our relationships, whether it's family or friends, help us or hinder us in living for God? How would God have us to live in the scope of relationship? We live for him. We center all relationships in him. You say, I got relationships with lost people. How do we do it? We bring Christ right into that. We put him in the center of every relationship. Whether it's my relationship with my wife or hers with me or ours with our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, our relationship with each of you, we put Christ in the center of it. He's the pillar. He holds up the entire structure. We have a new family. Each and every one of you out there who are born again, children of God, in the family of God, we're family together. We're brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers, aunts and uncles, grandparents and great-grandparents in the family of God. And we're to care for one another with that same deep, loving, familial commitment. Jesus gives us a new dimension in family. I've got a great earthly family. My mom and dad, they're gone. I've got brothers and sister-in-laws and nephews and nieces. I've got a niece. I've got a great extended family with Sherry's family and all. I would tell you some in my earthly familial family, some are also in my eternal family, and some are not. Those who are not, that relationship will fall away when death comes, or the rapture, or the resurrection. But for those who have a relationship with Christ, not only will we have a temporal earthly relationship, but that will carry on into eternity. Think about it. I remember Asa Teasley. You know, he was about 94 at the time, and still Sprice Build, still working, still everything. But we sat one day, and we were talking, and we were having lunch together, and he said, "You know, Mike, I got more family over there than I've got over here. And someday soon, I believe, I'm going to go see that family over there." Isn't that true? Someday, we're going to be joined together with our family over there. May God bless you. Father, I want to thank you so much for the love and mercy that you show us. I thank you that you have gathered us together as a family. And that, Lord, we can love each other with such a deep family love. I look out here and I see brothers and sisters that, Lord, they've been our family. They are our family. I think of those precious moments spent with so many. God, you made that all possible. For even as I share a common life with my earthly brothers and my earthly parents, I share a much greater common life with each one of these, my brothers and sisters in Christ, for we share the very life of Christ together. To you be glory, Lord. Let us live in light of that today. And let us, on our heart, Lord, reach out to those who are our brothers and sisters in Christ and let them know how precious they are to us. To you be glory now, Lord. Take us through this day, and Lord, do in our heart and life what you have chosen to do from the foundation of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for this morning. You have enriched me and blessed me, and I pray you have a great day. And for some of you, I'll see you at brunch here in just about a little over an hour, and we'll get together, enjoy the fellowship together at Davidson's. Come on down. If you're here in this area, and join us. We'd love to have you there. Davidson's on 99 and Walnut. God bless you. We'll see y'all later.